My name is Rich Schmidt. I'm here with Ewald Mosler. It's January 11th, 2021. We're at Teutonic Wine Company in Portland. Thank you so much for joining us today, Ewald.
Thanks for inviting me.
First question, and as you know, most important question, is why wine?
Yeah, basically, I get asked that question quite often. And not only by wine, but why wine in Oregon? I always have a kind of a very quick short answer to that. I tell the people, if you are born with the name Mosler and you come from the Mosel Valley, then you have almost no other choice in life than go somewhere and promote Mosel wine or German wine. So that is a quick answer. However, of course, it is much more complicated and detailed how I came to Oregon and how I get into wine. So, but definitely, I really think, you know, that I was born in the Mosel Valley. It's basically, it started there, you know. My family, we had a few vineyards there. It was very small. My father basically passed away when I was five months old, but my mother inherited a few vineyards from their parents, and they cultivated these vineyards. Mm-hmm. And honestly, if anybody would have asked me, you know, oh, do you ever want to be in the wine business, I would have said no. Because a lot of things what I associated as a kid with the vineyards was quite negative, you know. My mother had to work for other people in the vineyards, and then I had to go to to other people taking care of me. Mm-hmm. And daycare, that is what I wanted to say. And so that was, my mother was gone the whole day and so on. And then I have a sister, if she took us to the vineyard, it was kind of boring in the vineyard. It was in the winter too cold, it was in the summer too hot, and we were thirsty and hungry, and you know. So vineyard was not my favorite thing. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And yeah, that have changed then in the coming years. I was also, when I became a little bit older, I was not really the hard vineyard worker, you know. I had to help in the vineyard, you know, cultivating the soil and so. And my mother sent me to the vineyard, and she was watching me from across the river. And she said, oh, I hope he does a second line up, you know. So most of the time when I walked one line up, I came home. So vineyard, as I said, was not a kind of a favorite thing. However, you know, the Mosel Valley is a very nice place to live. The town I lived was at that time 500 people. We lived in a small street. There was around 9-10 houses, and at the harvest time, almost everybody was crushing grapes except our family. Our vineyard was too small, so we belonged to a little co-op in the village. Mm-hmm. So we delivered the grapes there. To give you an idea, you know, the amount of grapes what we harvested together with my grandfather, from my father's side, was one barrel, not like a barrique here, but in Germany we have this 1,000 liter barrels, but it's the amount of four barriques here. So that was basically the total amount of grapes we harvested. So, yeah, I am surprised, you know, that I ended up in Oregon, because again, in my childhood and as a teenager, I didn't have a lot of self-confidence because, you know, as I said, you know, our father died, and my mother had to work very hard, and we had very small vineyards. Mm-hmm. And all my friends, they had a tractor at home, and pushed the wagon for the harvest time in the with the tractor in the vineyard, but my grandfather put on the cow, you know, and brought the wagon to the ferry boat, and you know, so it was very simple and very basic. So I always thought, oh, we are the very poorest family in town. Of course, there was a few other families who had owned a few vineyards. Everybody, I would say, every family had vineyards there. So, and. Yeah, I think it changed basically when I went to the military, you know, when I was 19 years old, so up to 19 years, I was living in this town, and I thought there is almost nothing around outside this town, you know. When you live in the Mosel, I mean, you even don't know the neighbor town at that time, you know, I born in 53. You don't know the people from the other town or across the river. So this, really, you live in this town, and I thought, oh, that is the world, you know. And I also had the idea that the best wine in the world is produced in our town. Yeah, even, you know, our town is called Zeltingen-Rachtisch. Zeltingen is the bigger part, and Rachtisch, where I grew up, is the smaller part. Zeltingen had basically the more famous vineyards, you know, than our town. But anyway, one time when I was 19 years old, I drove with a friend to south of France, and I remember we passed to Burgundy, mm-hmm. and I saw all these vineyards, and I was amazed. Wow, there's so many vineyards here. And but I thought for myself, oh, the wine cannot be as good because the vineyards are not as steep as in our area. So I was very naive. So. Yeah, as I mentioned, you know, then with 19 years, I was called into the army, in the German army. I didn't want to go there. And but then I noticed that I had a gift, a natural gift, was of interest for many other people, you know. I remember one time a general came and we stayed in line, and he was saying, oh, what's your name? And I said, Mosela. And then he was saying, where you come from? And I said, from the Mosel. And he said, oh, Mosela, from the Mosel. Interesting, interesting. And so, yeah. And yeah. So, and then, you know, I brought wine up to the base, and the people always said, wow, you know, it's the wine. I have to say, even I didn't like the vineyard, but before 1971, we are encouraged, my sister and I encouraged the vineyards from my father's side, mm-hmm. Grandfather, grandparents. So we had a few more vineyards. And harvest time was always very special, you know. But so in 1971, when you know the German history a little bit as well, in 1971, the Germans created a new wine law, you know, and he created these names, Kabinett Spätlese Auslese, a kind of a quality level, mm-hmm. But rates the quality and the ripeness level of the grapes at the harvest time. And before 1971, almost every little town had also a little negotiate, a little co-op, mm-hmm. and small growers like our family delivered the grapes there. But in 1971, this little village co-ops was eliminated, and they built one central bigger co-op in the town of Bernkastel, but it's only, you know, 5 minutes away from my hometown. And so our family was too small to be part of that. So my sister, in the meantime, got married, and also in the winemaker family, I mean, everybody is a winemaker family. And so we decided to make our wine ourselves. So in 1971, 73, 75, and 76, we made our own barrel of wine. And so when I went to the German army in 1973, there was some wine available, but I could bring it to my friends there. So that was the first time I noticed, wine is something very special. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't want to go on too long here. I have another question, but I can,
Well, sure. I mean, you're in the army, you notice the wine is kind of a powerful thing.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
What's the next step for you at that point?
You know, one experience I had in the army, but first of all, all my uncles and my cousins, and so all of them was winemaker, and they had really, you know, their own production, their own label and things like that. And I took vacation time every harvest time for 2 or 3 weeks, and I helped to help to carry the grapes out of the vineyards. You know, we had this kind of back container. You know, get kind of 4 or 5 buckets in that back container, and then you walk up and down the hill. You know, and I of course was a strong guy, and so you do that the whole day. And going back a little bit to my younger years, you know, that was also, as I mentioned, you know, harvest time was always very special. But when I was strong enough to get a little back container for 2 packets, buckets of grapes, and I could carry grapes, that then people said, wow, you're a strong guy. And so then it became a lot of fun to do that and, you know, things like that. But back to the military, so I took vacation and helped my cousins and my neighbor, you know, to carry grapes out of the vineyards. And the harvest time was always extreme special, because in the evening, after harvesting the whole day, you press the grapes, and then people, neighbors came by, and you drink wine and things like that. So, yeah, so wine also was in that little town, I think in every little town in the Mosel Valley, was an everyday thing, you know. Mm-hmm. It was always available. Even we didn't produce our own wine for up to 1971, but there was always wine at home. I remember my grandfather, when he came from the church after mass on Sunday morning, he came at home. My mother opened a bottle of wine. We had these little cups, you know, not a stem glass, like this thing here, you know. And so she put him a glass of wine, and my grandfather was always saying, "That is one mouthful of wine." So he drank it, and then he talked about stories and things like that. And a half hour later, he had another cup, and then he went home to. So wine was always there. And I came to the military, you know, and I didn't want to go. I was not really a military guy, but they called me in, you know, and I went to the airborne and I jumped and things like that, and I became a ranger. I mean, I'm totally perfectly trained as a soldier, you know, not that I am trained myself, but I trained all the other people as a sniper and, you know, and all these kind of things. So I was a very professional soldier. When I was 27 years old, the base asked me, the lieutenant or whatever it was, "Hey, you want to sign up for your whole life?" You know, that meant I should have stayed in the army to my age of 53 and then retire, you know. And I said, "Yeah, you can try," because only a few people was selected at the time who applied. And I thought, "Oh, they don't take me anyway, but, you know, let's give them a try." And of course, they took me, you know. So, and but then in 1985, so I was there from 76, so 12 years, 12 and a half years. I had the feeling I had done everything. Now I had a kind of higher rank, and, you know, and I thought, wow, now it is only a job, and is that my life now? And so I quit, basically. And there was another second lieutenant. He also was a ranger. And so we said, wow, let's go to Canada, basically, and find out if I really can survive in the wilderness. So that was a kind of a motivation, you know. So, and so we flew to Vancouver and traveled to White House, went down the Yukon River for 600 miles in a canoe, and went to Alaska and things like that. So he went back after a few months, and for me it became a trip for one year, you know. I traveled down on the West Coast. I passed to Oregon and went to California. I want to go to the Napa Valley to experience the harvest there. But when I came to Napa, it was already a little bit late because the harvest was much earlier than it was happening in Germany and so. So, and I think that is the point when it really starts that I made a decision to get in the wine business. What was happening is I met a woman in the Napa Valley, and I spent a couple days with her. And one day she was saying, oh, I need to drive back to Oregon. You know, she was living in Ashland. And it's a long drive and so on. And I said, oh, I have nothing to do. I hitchhiked basically, you know, all the way from Alaska to San Diego and even to Mexico and so. But so it was all a kind of outdoor trip, you know. Mm-hmm. And I said, oh yeah, I drive you to Oregon, and I always come back to the Napa Valley, and you know. So, but then I spent a few months in Ashland, and one time I went to a sweet shop to get some ice cream, and I heard a guy speaking German there. And I have to mention, you know, my English was very bad, you know, at that time. Even I studied some English or so, but it was always my weakest subject in school, you know, so I have not practiced speaking English, you know, and I never used it. So it was just a kind of a basic thing, you know. Mm-hmm. And I was happy that somebody spoke German there, and so, and it was a guy from India. And so I said, oh, you're from Germany, or you speak German. And he was saying, yeah, you know, I studied in Germany, I live now in Ashland. And then, what you're doing here? I said, oh, I'm traveling. And so, and then we talked about wine. And he said, so what are you going to do when you're going back to Germany? I said, I will be in the wine business. And I have to say, when I quit the army, you know, it was a kind of a big step in my life, because my life was very secured, you know, everything was very easy, you know, there was the Cold War, but it wasn't really a war, you know. The German army was very liberal, there was a lot of free time, you know, and when you did the service, service for a week outside, and you get a few extra vacation days, so I had months of vacation, you know, and I traveled with many people all over the world, you know. But so, and but when I left the army, I had a kind of sleepless nights, you know. I thought, oh, you know, now what are you going to do? And one night, you know, I waked up and I said, and I had an idea. At that time, you know, I thought, oh, wine is a kind of a great thing and thing. And I want to start a wine business in Germany for tourists who come to the Mosel Valley and bring them to wineries. And so it's a tourist and wine business. That was my idea. So I had saved a little bit of money, and I thought, okay, a certain way I use for traveling, and the other amount of money I save when I come back to Germany and start my business. So that was the idea. Mm-hmm. So that is what I told this guy from India. And he said, wow, that sounds so interesting. This wine should be available here. And I said, ah, yeah, America is amazing. I have been one time before in 1981 on the East Coast, traveling from New York to Key West. So it was my second trip to America. And I said, wow, America is so exciting. So it was a kind of a love for America. And look into that, you know. So after 1 year, I flew back to Germany. I spent only 4 months in Germany, but I went to everybody who had anything to do with wine export. And so I went to the Chamber of Commerce. I went to some other companies. I talked to some people in my hometown who exported wine. And I know a very small exporter gave me a booklet what was saying how to export wine to the United States, you know. So I read that book and I studied it, you know. So after 4 months in Germany, there was basically two companies. So the whole population in Seltingen and Rachtisch, my hometown was 500 maybe at that time, 700-800 and so. So it was less than 3,000 people, you know, 2,500 people. And there was one company, Selbach is the name, and it was basically the biggest winery in my hometown, you know, and they just started to export wine to another importer in on the East Coast. Mm-hmm. And I talked also to them, but the people was not there when I went there. And but just a week before I was ready to go back to the United States, you know, to start the wine company, the family Selbach called me up and said, "Oh, Ewald, we have heard you want to go to the United States and import wine, and we would be interested to talk to you." And so then I met with them, and he said what he did already, and make a long story short, but that was the first company who exported wine to me, so I had only 13 different Selbach wines when I started. So
that was in Ashland. So I flew back to Ashland. I thought I'd go
to LA, basically, because a big population of people. So I flew to LA first, and I checked around, you know, buying shops and so.
And I called up the guy in Ashland. His name was Abe, basically. And I said, "Hey, Abe, I come from a small town, you know, 500, 600 population, and Los Angeles is pretty big. I really don't know where to start." And he said,
"Come to Ashland."
And
I had no idea about all this paperwork and all these kind of things and licenses and so. And then I drove to Ashland. And we were sitting together and we looked. I mean, at that time there was no computer. we called up the OLCC and we asked, you know, what has
to be done. And
so we collected the information and
filled all the
applications and so. And it basically took 1 year to get all the licenses together. And Abe was saying, instead going to Los Angeles, check out Portland, Oregon. That is almost like Germany. So so that is why, and there's a lot of good restaurants. Yeah? And that was in 1986.
So that is why
I went to Portland, Oregon.
And I was living first in a dormitory
at PSU, took a few English classes and
things like that. And every few months I flew back to Germany, you know, so because I had only a visitor visa.
And the business what we started went basically of Abe's name, the guy from India. Mm-hmm. So it was all him.
And the idea was, you know,
I get the wine in Germany, come over here, promote the wine, you know.
They're selling a container of wine, and then I live in Germany, so I never was,
it was never my intention to live here. So after 1 year, we had all the licenses. You know, a little warehouse in the basement that was not bigger than a container. And so then I ordered a container of wine from Selbach, 1,000 cases, you know, because I had no idea how the wine business works. I thought, I'm selling 25 cases to this restaurant, 100 cases to this restaurant. The container is gone in a week, you know.
Everybody must
love this wine because the wine from my hometown is the best in the world. So I was pretty naive.
And
I
go back to Germany and we're getting ready for the next container, you know. And so that was
basically my business plan. So then the container came, we unloaded the container.
It fit just in that little warehouse.
And so then I start selling wine, you know, and
still my English was almost not existing, you know. And I left after the dormitory on PSU. I rented a little place somewhere, and there was another family guy, a couple living below, you know, was an Egyptian guy,
and we became friends and so. And so he said, "Oh, what do you do? In the phone book, there are all these wine shops, you know, and then you make some
cold calls and say, 'I'm Ewald, I'm from Germany, I sell German wine, and,
you know, can I make an appointment?' You know, so that was, you know, so I practiced that, you know, and made these cold calls, you know, and called, you know, these wine shops and so. And then I heard sometimes the people saying, 'Hey, Mike, can you come over? There's this guy, I cannot understand the word. So it was like that. Yeah.
But I remember my first sale was to Woodstock Wine and Deli,
A little wine shop.
And he bought 6 bottles of wine. That was my first sale.
And the wine at that time was around $275, $295 a bottle wholesale, So that's how it started. So then I noticed it's not a good idea to go back to Germany, I mean, you have to be here and selling wine, But, then I flew back to Germany and now it was very interesting because I was...
First of all, when I was 16 years old,
I had a blue-collar job.
Then I came to the army, so I was this kind of,
Guy, outdoor guy, and so now Abe, who was also a salesman for a pharmaceutical industry company, who always visited doctors in the suit, he said, oh, if you want to be successful in America, you always sell wine in a suit, so you go to the business. So I had my black suit in Oregon, and I, and when it was raining, I had an umbrella and my bag of wine, and so that is how I was selling wine there. So now, of course, I feel like the big businessman in Oregon, and I came back to my little town, and I was, wow, Ewald, he's so, and
I became a little bit arrogant,
so now I'm a businessman, So that went on only 1 year. The company at that time, called Vintage Europa, it doesn't make much sense, but it was an idea for my Indian friend, and said, okay, we do it Europe, because then we are able to also bring eventually French wines and Italian wines, things like that, so. And he was not working in that business, it was only me, But after 1 year, he was saying, do I talk too much, or you want to have other questions?
No, it's perfect.
Okay,
perfect.
Good. After 1 year, he was saying, there is no really money in this business, and the risk with the alcohol and the liability is too, and it was all on his name, of course. It's very high. I think I want to go out of it, I said, oh yeah, but now I have this warehouse full of wine. And in the meantime, I sold all this wine, and we get already a second and a third container. I mean, it was selling, every few months I flew back to Germany, because at that time, I think you get a visa for a half year. You could stay 6 months, I mean, he was not allowed to walk, really, but I only was the outside guy who promoted wine and things like that,
And then in 1990,
Then
Abe
went out of the
business,
I said, oh, I have all this wine, what are they doing now? And at that time, there was two other importers for German wine. So my story is more a German wine story in Oregon. Even today, I work with the Oregon winery, but it's most of the time was German wine. At this time, there was two importers who, besides having this very cheap wine, Liebfraumilch and Brunan, but was quite popular here in the US market. There was two importers who was focused on fine German wine. One guy was living on the East Coast, his name was Terry Thies, and I met him in Germany a few times for Selbach because he was also the importer. So I met Terry and we tasted wine together and so. And another guy was a guy in California, in San Diego, and his name was Rudy Wies. A little bit older guy, older than I was. Terry Thies was around my age. And both of them have started a year or a couple years before that. So everything was still very young and so.
And
Rudy Wiest wine was already available in Oregon here, and he decided to work with very fine producers who all was members of a high quality group of Germany called the VDP, Organization of High Quality Producers and so. So he had only wines for that organization, and the director was the director of that organization. He was his exporter in Germany, and Rudi Wies was the guy here. So I saw his wine, so I was basically his competition here in Oregon, you know.
Lemmer Wine Company had Rudi Wies wines.
And I called up Rudi Wies and I said, hey Rudi, you know, I also importing German wine and I'm in Oregon, I see your wines around and so on. And so on. And a week later he called me up, he said, hey Ewald, I'm coming to Oregon, you know, I may want to make some changes, you know. So I as I
learned later, he took some information, he said, there's this crazy guy running around selling this not so popular wine, you know.
It was all negotiated wine, but I had it in the beginning. And but he is quite successful. He's pushing me out of the market also. And
so he came and I said, hey Rudi, yeah, if you want to stay,
you know, you can stay with me. At that time, honestly, I had even not a bed here. I had only ever sleeping on a mattress on the floor. And I bought my first futon for Rudi Wies. I said, oh, he's coming, and you know, maybe I invited him, you know, maybe I should buy a bed. So, and yeah, so then he came and I told him the story. I said, oh yeah, I'm a little bit in a kind of a difficult situation because you know, my partner wants to get out of the business and so on. And he said, there's another company called Domain Selection. At that time it was Classic Wines and then we changed the name. And they're very nice people and I'm planning to talk to them too. And so I want to make some changes. And so, and I have met the owner of Classic Wine. His name was Konstantinos Ariston, the Columbino. And one time at a supermarket or a wine shop, he said, hey, what are you doing here? And so, and I said, oh, I'm selling some wine. He said, are you crazy? And so, and he was from Greece, you know, and I traveled many times to Greece, so we had something in common, and you know, we became friends, you know, and so, and I said, oh yeah, I know Dino, and so. So anyway, Rudi Wies said, okay, you know, I would give you the German wines, you know, and you know, if you maybe talk to Dino, so, and he can, he have all the licenses and all this kind of thing. So, and that is what I did, basically. So then I moved to Domain Selection. So the following years, the wine was imported by Domain Selection, you know, and I came over here and still promoted wine and things like that, so. And then came 1990, you know. I flew back to Germany like a few times a year, you know. Had a ticket over Canada and went to the Mosel in my black suit still, you know. and then after 2 weeks I went to wine shows and things like that and met with some other growers and so. And when I tried to fly back to Canada, the US immigration said, what are you doing here? You're flying in and out, and said, oh, I'm promoting German wine. And the immigration guy, officer, was saying, no, not with this kind of visa, you know, here, you know. So I tried to go by Greyhound into the United States, and yeah, I couldn't fly. And that didn't work out, so they took me out, so I walked in my black suit, I walked with my two suitcases between United States and Canada back to the Canadian border. And anyway, I had to fly back to Germany, and I talked to a lawyer in Seattle on the phone, and he said, it doesn't work, you know, you need to go back. And so the exporter for Rudi Wies, you know, his name was Fritz Haag, and I think he just passed away a few months ago. And so he was a very powerful person, and I visited him and he said, hey, you're back, you should sell wine in Oregon. And I said, yeah, you know, I had a little problem. You didn't let me in there, you know. And so we talked, and he said, oh, yeah, it's so hard to find people here. We want to recultivate our
best part of the
Braunberger Jüffer
Sonnenuhr, the vineyard, you know, one of his best vineyards, the Sundial, and the vineyard just below the Sundial.
And he said, yeah, it's so hard to find people, and so. And I said, oh, Mr. Haag, I said, I have nothing to do, you know, I come and help you, you know. And so.
So then Beer was recultivating this vineyard.
And how that is done in Germany, and maybe not today anymore, but at that time, as wide as the vineyard is, you know, you build a cave 3 feet deep, 3 feet wide, you shovel the soil behind you, you know, and then the next 3 feet you put in that hole and then you turn the soil over so the young soil comes on the top, you know. So that is how it was done.
Well, mostly I had plasters
on my hands. And but by doing that, I became extremely good friend with Fritz Haag. And I have to say that I couldn't enter the United States was the best thing that ever could happen to me. Because Fritz Haag, we became friends. You know, we have this formal thing in Germany, Z, you know, when you talk to a person who is older or not a friend, or you have Du. So Fritz Haag offered me, oh, you can say Fritz and Du to me, you know. So, and because he was a very influential person, he showed me around to all other major estates in Germany, and he said, oh yeah, that is Ewald, you know, he sells my wine in the United States. And so, and then, you know, I had access to all other producers, you know, so, yeah. So eventually, you know, I think it was a half year or 5 or 6 months I had to stay in Germany and do some paperwork. I flew back to the United States
and then get a lawyer
and we created a corporation, you know. So then, after 1990, this
whole thing became more structured and legal. And so
then I got my own import license and things like that.
So that is how it started, you know. And I have to say, you know, in Oregon, even in the
beginning when I came, there was this first generation of Oregon winemakers, you know, Bill Fuller and David Adesheim and Myron Redford and so on. And even it was a kind of a competition, you know, I brought other wine here and they want to sell their own wine. But I have to say, all these people, this first generation, supported me in the beginning because, you know, they invited me one time because, I, you know, first of all, I could not understand, you know, that I showed the wine around. And very few people like this wine, you know. I mean, almost nobody liked it, you know. So I don't want to say that I was the first one, but I did tastings in a supermarket because in Germany, so, you know, wine is not a big thing. Yes.
If you sell potato chips or wine,
it's basically the same thing, you know. And so I said, oh, I do tastings in supermarket. At that time, you had to get a license from OLCC for 1 day. You had to go to the police department and design it up and so, and then they could pour wine there for an hour or two. So, and I remember, you know, people came and said, what, a wine tasting in a supermarket? I never have seen anything like that, you know. And what are you serving?
And I said, I'm serving German wine.
Well, it's so Riesling, all the wine was Riesling, what I imported.
And the people,
not all, but
many people said, oh, okay,
and they turned away, you know. So even they didn't want to taste it, you know. And so they have the best wine in the world, you know. So, yeah. But one time, Myron Redford invited me, and that was already after 10 years on the market, or he was 10 years on the market or whatever. And he said, oh, you know, we're going to have a vertical tasting of the last 10 vintages or 12 vintages, you know. And his wine, Riesling, but tested Riesling, of course, was all a little bit on the drier side, you know. And at that time, dry wine was not so popular. Dry Riesling was not so popular as it is today. Most of the Mosel wines in particular had a little bit residual sugar. Mm-hmm. So, and I thought, wow, you know, so. And I have to say, you know, this wine was just amazing. In particular, the older Rieslings, you know. I mean, it was different than the Mosel wine that I was used to drink, but it was very, very well made and very good, and, you know, in particular with a few years of age. So, mm-hmm. So I learned slowly to enjoy Oregon wine, not so much Pinot Noir, because I always thought Riesling is the king of grape, you know. Even I learned by then that not the best wine is growing only in our town. There was a few other wine regions and other villages with some very good wine too, and other wine producers. So, and then also it was very interesting.
At that time there was only a handful of wine distributors, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. Less than 10, I would say, you know, I mean, Lemmer and Hinsted and, you know, all this kind of domain
selection and, you know.
And I have to say, you know, also these people, the sales people supported me also all the time. I mean, I was very welcome in Oregon.
When the
Columbia Wine Company also,
when the sales people had to
create a wine list for a restaurant, they called me up
and said, "Oh, Ewald, I need also a few German wines, you know, I do this wine list, you know, what should I put on?" You know, so they asked me, and so I had to say, you know, I mean, the whole industry supported me.
And also what I learned
here in Oregon, I mean,
I had this kind of idea anyway before, you know,
because I
traveled quite a bit in Europe and when you, you know,
in the beginning it was only my hometown. I didn't, you
know other cultures and so.
But
then I noticed, wow, you know, when we traveled to Greece and to France and to England,
there was always people. When you
came in a difficult situation, you didn't know where to go, or, you know, and there was always people helping you. And so, I mean, people are very nice
everywhere. You know, it's the same experience in the United States. You know, and. And then also with wine, I noticed, you know, it was,
only a few people drank
wine at the time, but it was always what a lot of people was interested in, you know, wine,
and so
they want to be associated with wine. And
so
my position was really kind of cool.
So, mm-hmm. So anyway, that was how it, was in
that time, yeah. So yeah, then
there was a lot of people who had a lot of influence of
my business, you know.
For example, you know, the company I'm working with today, you know, 00 Wines.
Chris Herrmann, he was a friend, became a friend. He and his parents basically became a friend of mine.
In the
early 90s, you know, 95 or 96,
his kids and the kids from John Powell at Cameron went to the same school,
I think, and domain selection, I was
walking together with, you know, I still
had my wine together with domain selection, even I had my own license, I imported,
you know, mm-hmm.
And I have to say, when I got my own license, I changed everything. I changed it to Ewald Moser Selection, so that became the company name. And Domain Selection was the distributor for Cameron, yeah.
So we met,
and
Dino, he roasted a goat every year at the Cameron Winery. Mm-hmm.
Chris and his parents was invited,
and so, and Chris tells the story better than I do, but he said he heard this guy speaking German, and Chris speaks very good German. His parents are from Germany and came after the war, immigrated to the United States. And so
he talked to me, and, you know, and then
we became friends.
And Chris Herrmann
is a great wine collector, so he gave me access to many amazing wines to taste, you know, from all over the world. And
we
also traveled together to Austria and, you know, brought in some Austrian wines and things like that.
So, you know, and
today we are working still together, you know. So there's
a lot of people who had influence over it, you know.
And another person, for example, there was a wine shop, or if the wine shop is still there, Great Wine Buys, and the owner who built this wine shop, her name was Rachel Starr, a Jewish woman who always was in the shop with her older mother and so on. And I tried to sell wine to her, I called her up, and I couldn't get the connection. First of all, I was very, I feel very uncomfortable because, you know, of the history of Germany, you know. I never have met anybody in Germany who was Jewish, you know. And now, oh yeah, I'm Jewish, and so, oh, what should you think? And so I was really kind of uncomfortable. But at that time, Ross Rainey, from Isham Wood, was working at that wine shop also. And he was, oh, Rachel, you should get this wine from this German guy. And so, and then later, Rachel and I became great friends, and I even sold her wine. She produced wine also later. So always there was people who, you know, brought me a step forward and things like that. And she introduced me to a man who is also making wine now in Southern Oregon, and we are friends since the 90s, Peter Adesman, you know, and he had a wine tasting twice a month. Now it is once a month. He brings wine from all over the world, and then people come and we are tasting the wine blind. And since the 90s, you know, I drive every month to Ashland, and we are doing it together. We are setting up this tasting, and you know. And so Peter and I became also good friends, and so, you know. And we traveled also to Europe and things like that. So it was always people involved. Too. In my company, Ebert Moser Selection, it was for a long time a one-man operation. You know, I mean, in connection with domain selection and so. But at a certain point, I get my own warehouse because Dino had to move, and everything was too small. We were expanding. I brought more wine in and things like that. I had sometimes 500-600 different labels, you know. I mean, and I also noticed that, you know, I mean, I had not all, but most of the top producers from Germany, and also later from Austria, you know. And you want to do good for every winery, but you cannot do that, you know. There's always wineries who are selling easier and things, not because of the quality, but, you know, because the label and things, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why, but so and then some people getting unhappy and things like that, and they move on and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, that was the experience I made, yeah. I forgot, you know, what I wanted to say, but
go ahead.
But what I was saying is, you know, so there was a kind of a group of customers and people who became friends from outside, you know, and we are still friends today, you know, and but also there was, you know, in the mid-90s, there was also people joined my company. For example, there was a guy, Peter Lehm. You may know the name. He's a very authority on champagne right now. Wrote an amazing book, you know, and I can recommend to everybody to get that book, you know. Peter Lehm was working for a wine shop. He was the son of two doctors in California, I think, in San Francisco. And he should become a doctor too, as a wish of his parents. But he decided he liked wine better, you know, and he worked for a wine shop down in California, and later he came to Oregon. And he was always so excited when I came to the wine shop and brought my wine. And one day he said, oh, I'm going to travel to France, he said, you know, for 3 months. When I come back, I want to work for your company. So I said, okay, you know. So Peter Lehm was basically my first salesperson, also, you know, working together. I mean, he so when Peter joined the company, he said, wow, there's also this amazing Austrian wine, you know, there's this producer and there's this company in Chicago called Svin de Vino. They have all these top producers, you know, and so we should get these wines too, you know. And so that is how I came then to the Austrian wine. So we're contacted Vino, then we get all this kind of Herzberger and Knoll and Erich Spichler and things like that. And then, you know, we had all these amazing wines, you know, now also in Oregon. And then, you know, I became friends with Gustav Hermann and I traveled to Austria together, visited all these estates and things like that, you know, and found a few other ones that we brought them in, you know. So we had Vino in the meantime, also this other guy on the East Coast, Terry Thies, he had German and Austrian wine as well, in also Champagne, but we get also his selection, you know. So I had basically the Ebert Moser selection, the Rudy V selection, he was also VDP estates, and then the Terry Thies selection, Austrian and German wine. So we had so much wine here in Oregon, and there's no way you can make everybody happy. So, but it became basically, all the things was happen that I guess I became authority in German and Austrian wine. I was very
amazed about that because, as I mentioned before I came to Oregon, I knew very little about wine. I mean, I know
how to pick it, how to press it, you know,
and things, you know.
But I never, if you believe it or not, recently, I never tasted a wine from that company, Selbach Oster, in my own town, because it was just not available. I never tasted a wine from Chiche Prüm or Fritz Hagen, you know,
before I came to Oregon. So
almost everything that I learned about German wine, I learned in Oregon. So, and not that I learned it here, but because by doing it, by coming to Oregon, I was invited to
wineries. I went to the wine auction,
to trade shows in Germany, you know. And there was this crazy guy, you know, from Germany who did something in Oregon. And so, and it's the same like for you, you know. Maybe people come to you and say, oh, you know, Rich is the biggest authority on the Oregon wine history, you know, even he was not planning to do that, but you get all this information from the people, you know, everybody tells a story and, you know, and that is how it comes together, you know, and then eventually, you know, if somebody wants some information, it comes to you, you know, and so that's how it works in the world, I guess, you know, and so then, you know, people invited me. My English became a little bit better, and you can still notice today, I still have a strong German accent, you know, and I hope people will even understand what I say, you know, but people invited me, you know, they said, oh, can you do a wine tasting and give a speech on German wine? So I did on almost all the colleges over the years, and the Mount Hood College for people who go in the gastronomy business and so, or an Reed College, you know, they had a kind of a German house. I did wine tastings there, you know, get little wine seminars. I had a kind of a slideshow that became extremely popular here, you know, showing the vineyards and things like that. And I still do, I mean, not last year because of the Corona thing, but I always, for 25 years, I did a wine seminar at the for PSU at Lewis and Clark for the Deutsche Sommerschule am Pacific, the German Summer School on the Pacific, you know. So, and so all these people invited me, and also wine organization like the Economically Society, you know, everywhere in Washington and things like that. And so I gave speeches for hundreds of people, you know, and so now it was this wine authority, but, you know, I never thought that, you know, I know more than this, other people who drinking wine know.
You know, that is how it is. Yeah, then Peter Liem and a few other friends,
you know, created a wine shop, a wine bar, very nice wine bar in Portland, and so he left, and later he, you know, he went to New York and things like that, and then he became this authority on Champagne. And then I think you interviewed Chris Burke, you know, and he mentioned, you know, so Chris Burke showed up, you know, and I was not looking for hiring anybody, but Chris Burke showed up, and he said, hey, you know, I
want to sell this German wine. And so then
Chris Berg
and I worked together,
and he was
selling wine for a few years and things like that. So this kind of a journey. I mean, when I say, you know, I get the support, it's so interesting from many wine growers, you know. And when I'm looking back, you know, many people like Barnaby here, you know, our ways was crossing somehow, you know, and we are still friends, and so this, you know.
For example, one day, I think it was, I forgot the year, but David O'Reilly and Peter Rosbach, you know, they had together Chinon, you know. Mm-hmm.
And I think before that, David O'Reilly was the general manager of Alcove or so, mm-hmm. or sales manager, whatever. He had a kind of position there.
And he left
Alcove, and at that time I had my own warehouse and so. And he contacted me and he said, hey, I have this 25 Oregon wineries, very small wineries, you know, Sass and
Chinon and, you know, I forgot
all his names. And he said, yeah, I'm going to sell that, but can you do the distribution, you know, the
warehousing and so. So I had
two levels. I had a big basement and 2,000 square feet upstairs and so.
So the whole basement was full of
Oregon wine from David O'Reilly, and he was selling it, and we were shipping it for him, you know, with the German wine together.
So David O'Reilly
and I, we worked together
for a certain time, and so there was no disappointment in
Oregon, you know, and the business was growing like crazy. I mean, you know, it was like,
you know,
I mean, for
some reason, German wine became popular. And I heard that
say many, many times in German, Oregon is the best market for
German wine. And so
I don't know that, you know, but that was what people saying, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. And a certain time, that was also all in the 90s and maybe early 2000,
Rudi Wies called me up. Well, you know, I was working with him anyway because I had all his wine. He said,
hey, you're doing so well in Oregon, you know, I need some help in San Francisco.
And I was already operating on my own, not with domain selection anymore, I think. So I forgot.
Exactly, yeah.
Maybe
I was together with domain selection. But anyway, he said, I need some help in San Francisco. So,
besides running the business here in Oregon,
you know,
I was flying every month for 1 week to San Francisco.
And I visited all these amazing restaurants there, you know, and sold
wine there for Rudi Wies. And then I came back to Oregon and, you know, did everything here. But, I mean, whatever it was, you know, it was an amazing learning experience, you know, I mean. Then I know
how business is done
in California, and there it was really, you know,
the best thing is you go out in a suit or, you know, dressed very nicely, not so casual than in Oregon. In the meantime, I get also a little bit more casual in Oregon, so I didn't, you know, use my black suit for another 10 years, so. Yeah, and but then I expanded my business, and I don't know exactly what year that was, to Washington, and I told Rudi Wies, hey Rudi, I'm expanding also to Washington now. And that was when Chris Berg was joining me. And so I don't have time to come to California, but over a year, maybe a year and a half, every month I flew down for 1 week there. So, and then, yeah, Chris Berg first drove always to Seattle and to Bend and everywhere, and yeah.
Selling wine and, yeah, there was everything, and something interesting was what was also an amazing experience, you know. For example, when I got my own license in 1990, now I had to call up the get, you know, fill the forms for the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco and Firearm at that time.
Trade Bureau, what is it? Alcohol
and TTB, yeah.
Yeah. And so, and at that time was the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco and Firearms. So it was pretty crazy anyway, but so, and then I get a call from Vancouver, from that office, Mr. Mosler, you know, we are from the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco and Firearms, you apply for the license, but we noticed you have wine already, you know, for a while and things like that. And so, and they came and checked everything, and there was an issue with the label approvals and things like that, and you know, and it became a big issue. I mean,
I can get into that story, but
it's not so necessary, but we had to go to a hearing. I had to go down to California to the BATF for a hearing.
And eventually they gave me the license and things like that, you know.
And so it was kind of very difficult and complicated. But then,
years later,
when I was not really sure, do I need also a BATF license, a federal license, if I expand to Washington or only a state license? And so I called up the BATF again, and there was this woman, her name was Martha, and she said, "Oh, Ewald, you know, I'm so glad you called, and you know, and I just went to the restaurant, my husband and I had a bottle of wine, and said Ewald Moser selection, and you know, so everybody became very helpful, you know." So beginning, you know, it was so difficult, you know, they always said, "Oh, if you show you imported wine illegally, you know, you can go to the jail," and you know, so it then turned around, it became a very helpful organization. Another great experience that I had, I, on a certain point, you know, I was living in different places in Portland, and I met my partner, where I'm married today, you know, Miguel, and he found a house right on the Columbia River, and so I moved there on Zobie Island. I was living on Zobie Island for quite a while, and then that house was sold, and we only rented a place, you know, but it was an amazing place on the Columbia River, and so. But anyway, then I thought, oh, you know, I have this warehouse in Portland, and now I need another house. I'm looking for a place on Zobie Island with a warehouse, and then I can operate this business from home. And I found a very amazing place. It was just built a few years ago and had a kind of a totally insulated warehouse, like a kind of a six-car garage or something like that, you know, but it was. And I applied for the license for the warehouse license, and my neighbor, who had a kind of a mansion next to it, and so he was afraid that there would be too much traffic and things like that, so he blocked it and wrote a letter to the neighbors. And I have to say, you know, I never, you know, thought, oh, OLCC, you know, they give you only trouble. But I have to say, the OLCC came to neighborhood hearings and they defended me. They said, "No, Ewald, it's a small operation," and, you know, and I mean, they were speaking for me there. So I mean, people will not believe it, you know, that the OLCC can also be, you know, helpful and things like that. Was a black guy, I forgot his name, but he came to a couple hearings and was talking to the neighbors and they, you know, but yeah.
Amazing.
So, yeah, it's pretty good. So it seems like, you know, I mean, when looking back, you know, it's like when the kids playing with a little boat, you know, a little piece of wood, you know, put it in a river, you know, and it jumps down the river, this little thing. Sometimes a wave comes and the boat sinks, but then a second later it comes up again. So that's how I see my business sometimes.
You're very buoyant. That's good.
Yeah.
I want to back up for a second to Riesling. Obviously, Riesling is the name of the game for you, and is the wine that got you here. You mentioned that Riesling was not terribly popular when you started.
No.
Tell me about introducing Riesling to a market that hadn't really used it before, or wasn't really used to it yet, and how you got Portland to become more of a German wine place, or how you helped it get there.
Yeah. I mean, the thing is, you know, I mean, as I saw at that time, that also Pinot Noir was definitely one of the varieties like David Lett and so, you know, he was focused on. But there was also a lot of producers and small wineries who had a kind of idea on Riesling, you know, and also Chardonnay in the beginning, but Chardonnay became unpopular and then he went for Pinot Gris and, the German wine had this image, you know, sweet and cheap, you know, and that, and I think, you know, I mean, if I had a little bit impact on this market here, why Riesling became popular, I mean, every week and everywhere I did wine seminars and wine tastings, as I said, I had this slideshow later, it became a PowerPoint presentation, you know, and I was preaching wine everywhere, you know. Mm-hmm. And also what had a big impact, you know, I never thought about that, but I mean, this area, as I mentioned before, the Mosel Valley is so beautiful, you know, this the river in Germany is 170 kilometers, so around 100 miles, and you have also little towns, around 100 little towns left and right from the river.
And the vineyards are steep and so.
So my idea was to bring all the people here from Oregon, you know, take them with me when I went to a wine show, mm-hmm. and so, and or just had a business trip there. I always took people with me and showed them the vineyards and visited winemakers and things like that, you know. And that had a big impact. So I noticed, you know, if somebody, whenever somebody comes with me to the Mosel Valley, I mean, it becomes a Riesling lover, you know. I mean, then, wow, you know, and it was good for the business, you know. And so that negativity about Riesling was washed away because now the Saar place, you know. And then
he also discovered Oregon Riesling,
I think, you know. And
because it was different, but it was also good wine, you know, but different. And it's the same in Germany, you know, the wine from the Mosel Valley is totally different from the Rheingau or from the Pfalz or from Baden or from mm-hmm. anything, you know,
So, and that is the beauty about the wine. Anyway,
and so that was a great thing, and that is how
Barnaby, Barnaby came with me. This after running Ebert Mosel Selection for a while, the difficulty in my business was not selling the wine or you know, and
find customers because it
became better and better and better all the time. And so it was always a kind of immigration issue, you know, after being on just a visitor visa here for the first couple, 3 years, you know, and then it became a corporation. I had a visa, what calls a kind of an E1 visa, called the investment visa. Mm-hmm. And so, and that had to be renewed every 5 years, you know. And that was always a hassle. It was always more difficult to renew it than, you know, than I thought, you know. Each time I was planning to go for a couple of weeks, you know, I had all this paper prepared and so, and then it took a month or 2 months or, you know, or last time it took, 5 months again. So, and my company was running here, you know, with, so at a certain point I was thinking, you know, it becomes too difficult to do that, and I always had also in mind, I go back to the Mosel and, you know, and host people from America who come there and so on. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so
then at a certain point I joined Mitchell Wine, you know. So he took over the inventory and, you know, and he was selling the wine. So, yeah, and I was already with Mitchell Wine when I had another trip to Germany. I was not really employed, I only, you know, I promoted the wine, and Mitchell Wine was the distributor. So, you know, so I still did all this promotion on German wine, and I took a salesperson from Mitchell with me, and then also a woman. She was the wine steward from Whole Foods, mm-hmm. and then Barnaby. You know, Barnaby was my great customer. I think he told his story. You know, when I came to mm-hmm. so. And Barnaby, he wants to be a winemaker as well and producing Riesling in particular, you know. So Balbi came with me, and we had we traveled all over, and we had an amazing time. That was the first time, and then Barney and I
traveled a few more times
to Germany and visited other producers and things like that. Yeah, that was basically what changed the market. I think this wine seminars, you know, all the time, doing tastings in stores and, you know, wine shops and, you know, sit-down tastings and walk-in tastings and bringing people to the wine region, what I loved so much. And that was, I think, made a difference a little bit, yeah, to the market.
Sure. As your company was growing and you suddenly had more options for what you were going to sell, but you wasn't just you took what you could get, but you actually were selecting wines to import. Tell me what you were looking for in wines that you thought would fit in the Oregon or then the Washington or San Francisco market. What were the characteristics you looked for, and how did you sort of build out your portfolio?
Yeah, basically I have to say I never looked at the market. So there was no business plan and there was no market study what the market was asking for. I mean, I had my idea, you know, and I thought, you go for it or you leave it, you know. I mean, for example, I
was used to that wine, this is the sugar, and it was my favorite wine.
Cabernet Spätlese, you know,
but had good acidity and a good balanced sweetness and so on. I was not really into Dreyer full body wines.
And this wine, the Dreyer full body wine, was already produced in the Pfalz region and also in the Rheingau. In the Rheingau, it really, there was a kind of organization. Breuer was one of the first guy who said, okay, we need to get focused more on the individual terroir than on this German wine law with the ripeness level. I mean, I will come back to that, but so he said, okay, we're producing wine almost like white Burgundy, you know, focus on the individual terroir, and so and the wines are dry with very little or non-residual sugar and so on. And that was not my favorite wine in the beginning, but there was one winery in the Mosel Valley, and that was right where the Mosel flows into the Rhine, you know, in the lower Mosel, and the winery is Heimann Löwenstein. And I remember he started basically at the same time when I created my company here in 1987. He was a student, came home to his hometown, and he didn't, as I learned, he didn't inherit any vineyards because he was a kind of a revolutionary and things like that. And but he leased a few vineyards and bought a few vineyards, and in that area, the vineyards look totally different. They're all terraced. Mm-hmm. In our area where I come from, the middle Mosel and upper Mosel, the roads going up the hillside. So it's kind of a different thing. Totally rocky and unbelievable to cultivate. I mean, it's like, so but he had this idea. He calls all his wine Qualitätswein, but it's a kind of a lower level, or kind of an everyday drinking wine. It's a German wine law. But he focused very much on the individual terroir. And so he had this vineyard, you know, Uhlen, and that had different soil. Everything was very rocky, but there was a little bit iron in a certain part, you know, maybe less than a quarter of a mile wide. And so that was a red slate. And then in the middle, right next to that, almost every rock you lift up had a fossil. So there was a little bit more calcium in there. And then right next to it, there was blue slate, you know, there was no iron anymore. So he made different bottlings. Even there was one vineyard named Uhlen, but he did this Rotlei, red slate, Blaufüßerlei, the black slate, and then Laubach, that was the vineyard with the fossil. And other vineyards too, you know, but that, so, and all his wines was dry, almost totally dry, a little bit more full-bodied and so on. And when I tasted these wines, and Selbach introduced me to that, and was just amazing. But it took me a while to learn about that wine, you know. But by drinking more of these wines, you understand them more, you learn about it, and so on. And
yeah. So you mentioned Chris Herman earlier and 00 Wines. So tell me about the relationship there. You mentioned how early it started. Tell me how it got to you working with him.
Yeah, basically, I mean, after I have done everything in the wine business and things like that, and Chris and I was friends, and I have to say, what was amazing about Chris and also his father and his mother, you know, first of all, when I was invited there many times to their house and to Christmas and Easter and things like that, and they had always these amazing bottles, and always when we opened the bottle and they didn't know who is the producer, there was always wine books, you know, and we investigated where is this little parcel and things like that. And Chris and his father traveled many times to Burgundy and things. And you know, Chris is also a lawyer in the wine industry and things like that.
So I learned quite a bit. I mean,
not that I ever became a kind of an expert in Burgundies and things like that, but I said, wow, I mean, these wines are like this white Burgundies. You know, they are dry and minerally and fresh and things like that. I mean, I never looked at Chardonnay because there was Riesling and there was Chardonnay. When Chardonnay was buttery and big, I didn't like it, basically, you know. That's how my palate is. Not that I would say buttery Chardonnay is bad. I mean, that is also for certain customers who like that style of wine. It's an amazing wine, you know, but for my palate, it didn't do it, you know. But then we had these Burgundies, and some of them, you know, was 10, 20 years old and things like that, and they reminded me on this kind of dry Riesling and so on and so on. So that was a great learning experience about wines in the world. I never would have had a chance in my hometown to taste this wine. I mean, nobody had them there at the time. Maybe today is different, you know, with Selbach and Losen and, you know, so. But, so that was the thing. And
when Chris and his father started 00 Wine,
in the beginning I only heard about it, you know, Chris's father Richard was saying, oh, we are producing some wine, and it was very small, and he told me a little bit about it. And so that was maybe the vintage 2013 and 14. It was, he produced only a kind of a barrel of different vineyards and things like that. But then I learned a little bit more about it, and I learned,
Chris had a palate for amazing wine,
and he always was saying, I mean, if we do everything, and he had connection to the Burgundy producers, if we do everything, you know,
perfectly right and things like that, you know, can we produce
this high quality of wine like it is in Burgundy? And I think, you know, not only Chris, other people had that idea too, but, you know.
So then they created 00 Wine
with the focus on Chardonnay, and he hired this consultant, Pierre Millman, who is an amazing man from Alsace and consults many high-profile wineries in Burgundy and Europe, I have to say in Germany as well, and things like that, you know.
And, So then at a certain point I said, hey Chris, this is an amazing project you have, you know, and the taste of wine, and I want to be part of it. So, and I have to say, you know, Chris
and his wife running the company themselves, you know, I'm more a kind of a
background person, and
I do everything, and this, do some tasting sometimes. But taking care of the Oregon market, but also shipping wine. We have a kind of a little wine house in Carlton. The wine is produced at the Carlton Winemaker Studio. I take care of the house, that everything is organized and things like that. So I'm the
guy in the background
who does everything. So,
yeah. What's that experience been like for you working with a singular brand after such a career of working with all these different brands?
Basically, it is much easier to sell this wine than all this, you know, many labels and things like that, you know.
We had the idea to import also a little bit German wine, and we did, you know, we imported wine from Selbach and also Heimann Löwenstein, that's it, but I just mentioned and a few other ones. But then the tariffs came, you know, and so we thought, oh, you know. No, this is amazing how easy it is to sell these wines, even, you know, here in a much higher price level than the German wine ever was. And but I have to say, you know, when you open this wine and I go around with these restaurants, even sometimes the restaurant have not the customer base for that kind of level, but they say, wow, I need to put this wine on the list. And so, I mean, right now, of course, the restaurant business have a difficult time and things. But no, it is, it's amazing, you know, how easy it is to sell these wines.
So. I had a few other Oregon wines. I didn't stay only with German and Austrian wines. I had always other wines. For a while, I added also Ximena. What is the name? What is the wine? Ximena and Guy in
Debuter.
To forget the name of the wine now. But anyway, yeah, I will come back. But I had always some other Oregon wines. Not always, but sometimes other Oregon wines as well.
Yeah.
So I'm curious, so I was talking about Oregon wines, when you came with not really much of an impression of Oregon, and Portland was kind of a happy, sounded like a happy accident that you landed in Portland. Tell me about your kind of initial impression of Oregon wine and the wine industry and how you've seen it change over the years.
Yeah, I mean, in the beginning, as I said, you know, there was this first generation of winemaker, you know, and then there was the second generation, like David O'Reilly and Peter Rosbach and Shehalem, you know, and the thing is, you know, all these people, you know, that was one of my very good customers, you know, also they liked wine and so of course, you know, the industry have changed quite a bit, you know, there's more restaurants here. And the focus became really, I mean, the Oregon Pinot Noir became really the major wine, so for a while. And I think the latest new step is
moving away, not totally, but
from Pinot Gris and Riesling, and Chardonnay is
becoming the big thing. And a lot of
fine producers today, I mean, they are really focused on
not the California style of Pinot, and not the Burgundy, but the Oregon Chardonnay, you know, with a lot of focus on individual terroirs, on a little bit more freshness and higher acidity, and cooler climate vineyards, and so not so
very full body wines,
but wine with a lot of finesse. And
and that, I think, is a big change in the Oregon wine industry. So. Mm-hmm.
And I think it is
very successful. I mean, now I go to this Chardonnay celebration, and there's many great Chardonnays, you know, besides the Pinot Noirs. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Pinot Noir, I mean,
the Pinot Noir celebration was definitely a big change in the industry, you know, to bring winemakers in. I mean, I remember one of the first, do you remember when the first
87. IPNC? 87.
Huh? 87.
87, I think, 87
was the same time I started my company. So, and a few years later, I remember there was the first time German winemaker, Pinot Noir producers came to Oregon. It was Joachim Heger from the Baden region, the Kaiserstuhl, but was already focused on the Burgundy varieties like Pinot Gris, Pinot Blanc, and Pinot Noir, and he was
definitely one of the major Pinot Noir producers,
Pinot Noir producer in Germany. And another guy was from the Rheingau, and his name was August Kessler. And the Rheingau is, of course, it's mostly Riesling, but I think it's on the west side on the valley. There's a village called Assmannshausen, and that village was known for Pinot Noir, and August Kessler had vineyards there. And these two guys came one of, I don't know what year it was, but was really in the late 80s or early 90s. And I remember we visited David Adesheim, and then also Dick Ayers. Mm-hmm. And Dick Ayers still was living in a trailer on top of his vineyard there. Yeah, that was the first Pinot Noir celebration, and that was the first German winemaker who came. And, so, von Riesling, when I came to Oregon, I remember there was a winery. I had some girlfriends in the beginning, and one of my girlfriends brought me to a winery, Mühlhausen, and they had Riesling and other varieties. The winery doesn't exist anymore. Mm-hmm. And there was a cooking class, so I went to a cooking class and things like that. Yeah. And so the industry have changed, but there's still wineries like Barnaby. I mean, he went in a totally different direction, you know. So he produced Pinot Noir, but his focus is not the Pinot Noir, it's more the white wines, I would say, and in particular Riesling and things like that. So, and
what are your impressions of Oregon Riesling? How does it compare?
I mean, I have to say, I have to give credit to Barnaby. I mean, sometimes in a tasting, I would not see the difference between the Teutonic Riesling and the Mosel Riesling also. And I think, besides the individual terroir and things like that, you know, but the style, how he makes the wine, I mean, he really learned it at the mm-hmm. wineries in Germany and gets the information there. And yeah. And that's the way he produced the wine. And yeah, the wine reminds me of the Mosel, not so much on the Rheingau and things like that. Yeah. No, I think the. And there's other producers too, you know, who are making really amazing Rieslings. I mean, as I said, one of my first experience was with Myron Redford, you know, and that was a totally different style. And I was amazed how well this wine was aging. There's another interesting story I have to tell you. Roland Soles, you know, he called me up one time. And that is so amazing, you know, when I'm looking back, how we always crossed each other and things like that. Roland called me up one time and said, oh, Ewald, you know, I was in that restaurant in San Francisco. I had this amazing wine, and this wine had residual sugar, and it had acid, and it went so perfectly with the meal we had, you know. And how do they do that in Germany, you know? I said, Roland, I said, I don't know, you know, I mean, I'm not a winemaker, you know, but I know the slate have a lot of things to do with it, you know, the different soil. I mean, we have a lot of Devonian pure slate in the Mosel Valley. I mean, it gives the wine a lot of minerality and things like that. And a lot of winemakers focus on that and things like that. And there's a big diversity on wine because they don't make just one wine planting everything there. You do it from that part and that part, you know, so there's a lot of diversity. And he said, oh, can I buy a couple cases and so two bottles of each? And I said, sure. And I brought him these two cases of wine, and a few weeks or a couple months later, he sent me a list, and every wine he brought to his library, laboratory, and every wine was very analyzed, how much sugar, how much acidity, and you know, he had all these numbers and so, you know. So then, a few months later, he brought me a bottle, and it said on the back, you know, in memory of that restaurant in California, my friend Ewald Mosler, who inspired me, and he sent me a letter, he said, you know the vineyards in Germany a little bit, one of them is called Wehlener Sonnenuhr, and it's one of the, you would say, a Grand Cru vineyard in Germany, you know, right next to my hometown. And he said, Wehlener Sonnenuhr, watch out, you know. And so the wine was pretty amazing. It had residual sugar and acid and things like that. So there was all these little stories. So,
That's amazing.
Yeah.
I love that.
Yeah.
I'm curious, as you look back, you talk about all these people you've interacted with in the Oregon industry, from Chris Berg to Chris Herman to Barnaby to Rollin and all these other people you've interacted with, and you've had a pretty major impact on the market here. Tell me, as you look back, how do you measure the impact you've had? How does it feel to have impacted a wine scene like that?
You know, I as I said, you know, I I never would have mentioned that. If somebody would have told me as a child, you know, I mean, you will be in America and selling wine. I mean, any selling wine or be in America, I would have said, you're totally crazy. It's like, you know, when you, when a little group of friends want to play a soccer game and you have 10 friends and you said, okay, you come to my team and you to my team and then you to my, you know, the selecting and the worst guy is left over. I would have said, if the question would have been, who will be in the wine business? And I would have been the last guy selected, you know, so that's how I felt, you know. But again, you know, at a certain point in my life, I noticed that the universe or the earth or my birth, you know, gave me a special gift, you know, with a crazy name like Mosela, you know, but I mean, I didn't take attention of it in the past, but a lot of people thought I made it up, you know. But I thought it was an amazing gift that nature gave me, you know, and that brought me to the wine industry. And I never would have expected, you know, I mean, first of all, being in America, because on my first trip to the East Coast, wow, everything was so overwhelming and, you know, and so big. And you come from that small village, you know, and the whole life is there, and the people in the neighbor village speak a different language, I mean, a different slang, and so, you know, and you think that is the world, and so, and that is where I grew up, and that was my thinking, and, you know.
But, I never would have imagined anything like that, you know, the impact that.
Talking about bringing people to Germany, if you believe it or not, more than 1,000 people have visited my little town from Oregon or, you know, California, or, you know, who came and groups went over there, and, you know, and I connected them or took them with me and over this. So, and that have a lot of impact, you know, and another thing is, you know, but a lot of disappointment. I had more disappointment from Germany than in the United States. I mean, for example, Selbach, you know, on a certain point said also, you should pick up this winery, Dr. Losen, you know. He just took over, same thing, in 1987, you know, he took over, you know, the winery went to the father, you know, was in the politics and so, and it didn't make any profits, and the father said, if nobody takes over this winery, I'm going to sell everything, and then Ernie Losen, you know, stopped his studies, you know, and took over the winery. And he had a totally philosophy about how the wine have to be and so. And so then I brought Losen in. I was one of the first importers also for Losen wine. And Chris Herrmann, on a certain point, talked to a lawyer at Chateau Saint-Michel, and Chateau Saint-Michel had already a joint venture with a winery in Italy, Antonori, I think, and Chris was saying, hey, why you don't have a joint venture with a German winery, and so, and he was saying, yeah, that would be interesting, and so, you know, and so Chris said, hey, who you think, you know, I said, hey, Ernie Losen, he's a party guy, he always, you know, good time, and things like that, and so, why we don't talk to Ernie? I mean, I could have also said Selbach or so, you know, but Ernie was the kind of party animal, you know, and open for every crazy idea. And so, when we traveled to Austria, we visited also Ernie Losen and things like that. And we said, hey, Ernie, there is a kind of a good possibility to work with a Washington winery, you know, Chateau Saint-Michel. And Ernie said, oh, yeah, that's good, you know. So, a year later, he sent a winemaker, but it's also a famous, very great winery today, Vollenweider. Daniel Vollenweider was working for Ernie Losen. He sent him to Chateau Saint-Michel to show them how we pick the grapes by hand and so. They did that for a few years, but they noticed that it doesn't work because it goes too slow, you know. Then it is too warm, and you know, anyway, so. And so that was the connection. Then Ernie Losen built this joint venture, and he created this Eroica wine. So when you think about it, you know, it's all, if I wouldn't have come to Oregon, who almost nobody knew where it was. And I mean, people thought that it's close to Alaska, you know, even in Germany. And so if I wouldn't have had this, or this Indian guy would have said, oh, Oregon is like Germany, I never would have come to Portland, you know. And so, but it is a changed thing, and I cannot believe it myself sometimes, you know. But then at a certain point, you know, Ernie Losen, so then I imported his wine, but then we had this all this distribution to the connection from Chateau Saint-Michel to all over the United States. Before that, I was never a kind of a guy for the whole United States. You know, I never would have had the talent or to be a importer for a national importer, you know. And so, you know, I shipped a little bit to Hawaii and California, and some people who called me up said, hey, can I get some, you know, and then I shipped a few pallets or so. But I never was a kind of a national importer. I focused on Oregon and Washington, you know, and so. And but now with Chateau Saint-Michel, Ernie Losen had access to this distributor, you know, Chateau Saint-Michel are everywhere. And in a certain way, we are shipped wine to different distributors, you know. And then Ernie said, oh, you know, that's all fine to do it under Ewald Moser's election, but I think we should create our own company. So then I helped them to create Losen Brothers here, you know. And then our warehouse became too small. We moved his wine to, you know. And then Ernie went on his own. And even it came to that point, you know, I was not his distributor anymore. So, you know, things like that happened, and I'm not, you know, I always thought, yeah, that is how life is, mm-hmm. you know, I mean, coming and going, giving and taking, and, you know, everybody have to do what is right for them. I never was kind of bitter about it, even, you know, sometimes a little wooden boat underwater, and, you know, then it came up again, and so, yeah, so that is how it is. That's how I was looking at life, yeah.
I just got one more question for you then. What's in the future for you?
What's
in your future?
That is a good question because, you know, I'm honestly officially retired, even I'm working full time with 00 Wine. I mean, I love it to be connected to a winery with that high reputation and high quality. I mean, that is a whole new experience for me, and also dealing with customers now nationwide, or we are also exporting international now, and being connected with high profile wines. I mean, even I had high profile wines in Germany too, but you know, it's a whole different group of people, and it's a kind of another very amazing experience, you know. And I'm very comfortable to watch it and be part of it and do everything that it will be also successful. But I always think, you know, the older I get, the more homesick I get, you know, because this Mosel Valley is very small and you know, it's very comfortable, a lot of tourism there, and not complicated. So I think maybe at a certain time of my age, and if there will be more age, I will go back to the Mosel Valley. But also, I'm married to Miguel, who comes from Puerto Rico, you know, and that is also attractive to me, you know, kind of a, you know, island with warm climate, and even there's sometimes a hurricane, but that is happening live anyway. And so we have not decided, but so there's some possibilities for the future. But one thing is, you know, I mean, wine, it will be, as long as I'm healthy, and so it will be part of my life, and that it is, yeah.
That's all the questions that I have for you. Is there anything I didn't ask that I should have, anything we didn't cover here today that we should have covered?
I didn't give you a chance to ask any questions.
No, this is perfect. You answered them all. That's the whole point here, right?
Yeah.
Thank you so much for your time today, for your stories, for your amazing history, and we're going to go ahead and let you off the hook.
Yeah, thank you very much. It was a pleasure to meet all of you.
Excellent.